RealRacing.nz are beyond excited to be at the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame dinner this evening to celebrate the 9 latest inductees.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Steve Davis. I am one of the two MCs for tonight's 2021 New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame inductee dinner. Obviously, this has been delayed through COVID from last year, but it is just great that we are here for one of the more significant evenings, I believe, in our industry going forward, and that is looking back on those that have achieved so much. Before we move to the formal part of it, I need to get through the housekeeping. Clearly, this is a no-smoking venue. The toilets are situated to my left and right. And ladies and gentlemen, if you do have a mobile phone, I would ask that you put it to silent, if you would, just to allow those to watch the inductee videos and the interviews that will take place throughout the evening. Just going through the order of the evening, I'll shortly be inviting my co-MC, Des Coppins. You may remember him from radio. We'll bring Des back and bring him up here very shortly. We'll then hear from Cherry Taylor, who is the chairman of the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame, and we'll have a special tribute to the man who was the driving force of the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame, Mr. Chris Luoni. We'll then move to the inductees. We have 4 inductees. Prior to dinner tonight, we will also have the live auction, and you may have taken the opportunity of seeing it, of one special, very special item for the live auction, and that is James McDonald's whip, the whip he carried when he won his 50th Group 1 race. And we look forward to hearing from James and being inducted, but that is later on, but we'll have that special opportunity of buying a very special whip, and we thank James McDonald for his generosity. We'll hear from Bruce Sharrock, Deputy Chairperson of New Zealand Racing, Thoroughbred Racing, and then we'll have the mains. Dinner will be served. It is alternate drop. Now, I hope you're at a table with friends, because if you're not happy with your dinner, you have the ability to swap. So please, and if you have any special dietary needs, we trust that you have brought those to our attention. We'll then move to the final 5 inductees. We'll move to the Leishman Media Racing Awareness Award. Mark Chitty will introduce that. Dessert will be served, and we'll complete the evening with the remaining live auctions. That's the Stallion nomination, thanks to Little Avondale, a nomination to Per Encanto. What a run he is having and will continue to have. We have 2 bespoke suit jackets, which you can see displayed here, and we have an opportunity of buying a 3-day wellness retreat at Resolution Retreats near Cambridge, ladies and gentlemen. Gentlemen, it's getting close to Mother's Day. And then we'll wrap up. Hopefully we'll be closing off at about 10 o'clock. There are silent auctions as well, ladies and gentlemen. The silent auctions, I'll draw your attention to those. 120-day seasonal breeding package at Haunui Farm for either a dry or wet mare. We know there are many clients of Haunui already here. We have an entry form courtesy of New Zealand Bloodstock Insurance to the Pearl Series. We thank them for that. Kindly donated by the New Zealand Thoroughbred Breeders Association and New Zealand Bloodstock Insurance. Here's a special one. Paul Moroney, who's one of our sponsors tonight, is also offering a complimentary buying and selection commission for the 2022 Karaka sales, and that's poured forward by Paul Moroney. A skincare gift basket from Gracie Taylor, and Leveret Estate Magnum from our wine people, Mills Reef. That is all happening during the evening. Without further ado, the man, the silky voice, the man that we miss. Come back to the microphone. That's that silver thing there. Des Coppins, come up. How's it been?
Well, it's been great. I've been playing lawn bowls a lot. The big thing about lawn bowls, though, Steve, is the fact that, you know, you can be a gold card member, but you can still be classified as a junior if in your first year.
They tell me you're going all right, too, at the bowls.
I'm going okay. I've got a good partner, a guy called Grant Nisbet. And he goes all right on the microphone in the rugby field, but he's also a pretty good bowler, so he's teaching me a few tricks. But hey, look, it's a lot of fun doing things that you haven't done before, I suppose. And there's always something to do in racing, and I love this show. It's a great show, and 3 years, gee whiz, Steve, it's a long time since we were here. You explain the reasons why. Everybody knows the reasons why. But the fact of the matter is we have some people here tonight who have been inducted in the past, and I'd like to just acknowledge them before we carry on. David Peake. Stand up, David Peake. He's here tonight. Where are you, David?
He is standing, ladies and gentlemen. Looking good, David.
Linda Jones is here too.
Yes.
Great to see you, Linda. Dave O'Sullivan. Oh, yeah, Dave.
With David Peake.
Lance O'Sullivan's here as well. Graham Rogerson.
Graham.
Jimmy Gibbs. And representing the great man Ken Brown, his widow Anne Brown. But the way you started off, Steve, obviously you've been, you've got it down pat. I mean, I don't even know what these things are. I think they're microphones, but you've been doing pretty well. You've been known in Australia, I believe.
I did go to Australia and spent 3 months there, then came back and had the beautiful hotel quarantine courtesy of the Pullman Hotel, which I don't recommend too often doing. So thankfully, the bubble is open. I am pleased that you and I are socially distanced, which is good, with something we have continued on.
Yes, indeed, indeed. Righto, well, our patron of the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame is Cherry Taylor. I'd like to invite now Cherry to come forward and say a few words and give you the official welcome.
I'd just like to welcome you all here this evening and thank everyone for coming. As you know, the Hall of Fame was postponed last year due to COVID, so I'd like to make a special thank you to all our sponsors and to Sky City. They've all been very patient and stuck with us, and therefore we're able to put this function on tonight. I'd like to personally congratulate all the inductees. Well done. It's an amazing feat to be inducted into the Hall of Fame, and I'm sure you'll have a wonderful evening. I'd next like to thank our board. It's all done voluntarily, and to put on a function like this takes quite a lot of work. So I'd just like to thank the whole board for all the work that they've put in. They all work hard, and it's going to be a great night. So lastly, but certainly not least, I'd like to thank Michelle, who's our secretary. She's put in a huge amount of work into this evening, and without her, we couldn't produce this evening. Some of you may not know, but Michelle is Chris Luoni's daughter, and Chris Luoni was our past chairman, who unfortunately we've lost, and therefore the Hall of Fame are very proud to bring a tribute to Chris Luoni. Thank you.
The New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame is indebted to Chris Luoni, the man who was the driving force for establishing an organisation to celebrate racing excellence in this country. The local concept was inspired in 2003 when Luoni attended the Australian Hall of Fame Awards. New Zealand's racing heritage is filled with champions who enjoyed success at home and overseas. Luoni wanted to establish an equivalent organisation to honour these racing heroes. He confided in thoroughbred breeder and stud owner Gerald Fell, who was also in Australia. It became a shared vision, as Fell swiftly understood the importance of preserving our racing heritage. Together they were a formidable team, drumming up support for the inaugural awards in 2006. 14 champions of the turf were first to enter the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame.
Ladies and gentlemen, New Zealand has a proud racing heritage that will unfold tonight and be preserved for future generations to enjoy. Let's all enjoy the evening and make it a memorable occasion.
Now, at our 8th biannual awards dinner, that number has grown to 84. The organisation has always maintained a separate selection panel. The brief was that inductees should be a mixture of horses and people, old and new. It's been a winning combination, and Luoni has been instrumental in New Zealand's Racing Hall of Fame's success. Luoni's passion and commitment for the Hall of Fame was replicated in every aspect of a busy and varied life. George Christopher Luoni was born on July 13, 1951. He grew up epitomising the Kiwi saying, rugby, racing and beer. His parents, George and Jean Luoni, were publicans before introducing the family to farm life in South Waikato. An interest in rugby was ignited at St. Pat's School in Silverstream. Luoni was on his OE in Canada in the 1970s when his parents tasted racing success with Happy Union. It spurred Luoni to becoming an avid racing fan. Professionally, Luoni was an accountant, skills which blended well with the thoroughbred industry and its many participants. He combined both interests, framing many racing industry rules, covering breeding and GST. The Australian racing industry also tapped into his knowledge of racing and accountancy. Luoni experienced success as a breeder and owner, with stakes winners Ma Dan Seuss and Oliver Dance. He also raced Group 2 winner Balrani. Luoni's favourite horse was Cox Plate winner Phantom Chance. The retired champion went to live with Luoni and his wife Rosanna at their Woodbine farm near Hamilton. For 16 years, PC and Luoni shared an amazing bond. Colleagues, friends and family were amazed that Luoni found enough hours in the day to work full-time as an accountant at a major firm, manage a lifestyle block, and also provide community service to many different boards and organisations. Here is just a list of a few. This was a brief snapshot of the contribution Chris Luoni made to New Zealand. He was a successful businessman, but most of all, he was an even better human. The New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame will miss Chris Luoni.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I move to a response from the Luoni family, and it's great that Rosanna and the family are here tonight to be with us, I just want to echo, in fact, what was in that documentary and that tribute to Chris, and that is, we wouldn't be here tonight if it wasn't for Chris Luoni. He not only rang Gerald Fowle, he rang myself and several others after he had attended that night. He was the driving force, and I'm so pleased that we are here, because we've got to look back, we've got to acknowledge what we have achieved going forward. And I really do credit Chris Luoni with everything that we have done so far for the Racing Hall of Fame. But I have a response from the Luoni family, and this is it. Thank you to Chairperson Cherry Taylor and the Board of the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame. The Hall of Fame was a project very close to Chris's heart, and we know he would be very pleased to receive this acknowledgement tonight. Chris loved every aspect of the bloodstock industry. He was fortunate to be able to connect his professional life with his love of horses, and he was never happier than chatting with people who shared his passion. I can attest to that. Thank you to Annie Otway for the work she did in this video and all the other videos that will be shown tonight. And all these inductee videos were created early last year, and Chris was able to see them before he passed away. We know Chris would want to thank Tim Walsh for all the practical help and advice he gave him over the years and for just being his mate. And to the many people who helped our family during Chris's illness and since, some of whom are here tonight, we thank you. Thank you to Gerald Fowle for helping Chris to see out his vision, and to all the other board members, inductees and sponsors over the last 18 years who have helped make the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame a success. Chris believed that people should be acknowledged for their hard work and success. We remember him fondly as a champion for others. Hear, hear. Thank you.
But our first inductee tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is someone who might be a bit of a surprise for some, but once you've actually seen the video, you'll realise that this person deserves to be in the place of an inductees for 2021. Granny McDonald.
A Melbourne Cup winner is the ultimate for many trainers. Granny McDonald achieved that career-defining feat in 1938, yet her name was never included in the official records.
22 horses, the pick of Australian and New Zealand thoroughbreds, are entered for the classic race. Here are a few of them. The Trump, last year's winner. H&G, fine if it's wet. Alunga, gallant veteran. Marauder, the raider. St. Constant, watch that fight blaze. Royal Chief, the favourite. Catalogue, another New Zealand hope.
Hedwig Wilhelmina McDonald, forever known as Granny, had 14 years as a professional trainer in New Zealand before Catalogue lined up in the Melbourne Cup. She was the first woman to break racing's sexism barrier in her homeland, yet it still existed in Australia. The Victorian Racing Club didn't accept women trainers. Husband Alan McDonald had to acquire a temporary license to give Catalog and Granny their chance at glory.
Putting in a good run, but here comes Bourbon now.
The race was memorable for many records.
And stretching out, but the leader is still Catalog. Yes, the 25-1 shot is flying away from the field. There goes Bourbon setting out after Catalog now, but Catalog has it sewn up. And although Bourbon finishes fast, Catalog goes on to win by 3 lengths from Bourbon. Ortel Star fights it out for third place for the Lunga, who finishes fourth.
At the present, Catalog still shares the honour with Tory Boy as the oldest Melbourne Cup winners. They were both 8. The historic victory sparked a press debate about women's rights of racing, but it couldn't change the race records. Alan McDonald, a notable jockey, always credited his wife with the win, as did the owner, Tui Jamieson. An irate Mrs. Jamieson wanted to scratch Catalog after hearing that Granny couldn't hold a license. Granny wouldn't hear of it. She said it was the rule and it had to be obeyed. The race halted New Zealand's parliamentary business. Prime Minister Michael Joseph Savage was among the many to congratulate the owner, trainer, and jockey. They were all carefully noted in Granny's extensive scrapbook, as she wasn't in Melbourne to share the accolades. Granny experienced the thrill in Christchurch while preparing for the New Zealand Cup meeting. Granny grew up surrounded by horses. Her father, John Marr, was a trainer. Her mother died a few days after her birth, which might account for the quirky nicknames that ran in her family. Her twin sister was called Darky, and their older sister, Teenie. Granny showed exceptional ability on horseback from a young age. She won her first prize at 5. A few years later, she was winning against adult women. Granny was 31 when she asked for a training license in 1924. Authorities were unprepared for a woman ready to risk her social status by entering an all-male occupation. They couldn't think of a reason to refuse her application, and consequently, Granny is believed to be the first woman to apply for and receive a trainer's license. Wairarapa horseman Charlie Valance gave her some of his horses and was credited with helping Granny set up training stables in Palmerston North 4 years later. He even helped with wedding costs when she married Alan McDonald in 1929. The union required special approval. They needed permission from the New Zealand Racing Conference to marry. Alan's riding license carried a warning that he was to avoid riding in races where other horses trained by Granny were running. The couple didn't take long to post their first winner. 2 weeks after the wedding, Alan won twice at Whanganui. Alan was a master jockey over jumps. He was the leading jumps rider 6 times during the 1920s and won the Great Northern Steeples 3 times. But Granny soon attracted her own headlines. It took just 4 years to rise to 7th equal on the trainer's table. In the 1929-30 season, she was 5th and was never out of the top 20 for the next decade. For 8 seasons, Granny was among the top 10 trainers. Granny had the rare ability to train every type of winner: 2-year-old races, classics, cups, handicaps, sprints, hurdles, and steeplechases. The Melbourne Cup was a highlight. Winning the Great Northern Foal Stakes 3 years in a row, unprecedented at the time, the St. Ledger, Awapuni Gold Cup, Easter Handicap, and 3 Winter Cups confirmed Granny was a top echelon trainer. It's believed that Granny trained more than 300 winners during her 19-year career. The McDonalds did most of the track work together in the early days, taking great pleasure in schooling horses over jumps. Granny, loud and forceful, Alan, quiet and gentle. Granny had strict ideas about feeding and a knack for old-time cures. The prized Catalog benefited from those home remedies. Granny was quoted in the press after the Melbourne Cup win. A veterinary surgeon once condemned him for having a bad heart. This shows how bad his heart is. Granny's health deteriorated during World War II, and she relinquished her license in 1944. Alan took over the training duties, but wasn't in the same class as Granny. Granny's remembered for a will of steel and for being a tough businesswoman, yet she was known for a tender heart for the less fortunate and for children. Sisters Darky and Teenie were welcomed permanently onto the property of Palmerston North. Behind that family home is McDonald Place, a cul-de-sac in suburbia that will be a permanent tribute to Granny McDonald, the woman who trained a Melbourne Cup champion and broke racing stereotypes.
That's what the Hall of Fame is all about, unearthing real diamonds. Ladies and gentlemen, representing Granny McDonald, the family of, I'd like to ask Mr. Hilton Meach to come forward, and the sponsor, our own pioneer, Linda Jones. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Hilton Meach. Hilton, your relationship to Granny.
Mr. Gerald reckons I'm the only relation, but my step-grandmother was Granny's sister, Teenie, and so as a result of that, we went from 36 miles out of Denniverk and a truck over to Awaputi so I could meet my grandfather.
And he was, obviously, that was Alan McDonald, is that right?
No. Teenie was the step grandmother. And the three girls in the family had no children.
So you're just lucky to be here.
I told Bloody Phil that. I didn't want to be here.
We're pleased you're here, because I tell you what do you remember most about Granny McDonald?
Well, my father told me all the things that have been said, but which is terrific, about, you know, but she was, like the money they got out of the Melbourne Cup, they had a safe, so Rex Phil said, in the lawn. And it was empty, I think. But anyway, when we went over, she was old and small, and I was only bloody six or something, and I could look her in the eye just about. And anyway, but then she had a cigarette permanently in her mouth and a bit of nicotine underneath. But she was just a brilliant horsewoman.
Certainly was, Hilton. It reminds me of Freda White and the likes.
Well, Freda actually, she joined forces, you know, and rode show jumpers for Granny, and she would have learned everything she learned from Granny.
Well, I'm going to ask Linda to present you with the Hall of Fame memorabilia for you to take back as representing the family, and I'd then like to ask a few questions of Linda, who has made the trip over here as well from Australia. Our very own inductee, Hilton Meach, ladies and gentlemen, representing Granny McDonald. You know, Linda, I thought you were one of the real pioneers, but I reckon we've unearthed the diamond here in Granny.
I know. The only difference between her and I is she obeyed by the rules I didn't.
You want to enlighten us on that?
Well, breaking the rules of racing and going against everything, where she actually went with the flow. So, but I think, since I actually did a lot of research on her, I got out of the library, which I only found recently she had one, and she was obviously a very amazing horsewoman and a true lady, apparently.
And you had links too to the Granny McDonald legacy with hijinks?
Yes, I did. I sort of, when reading the book, and I realised that she had an association with the Fells and Trevor Knowles, and I rode for both of them, you know,
many years later. I'll tell you what, you also had an association with the other inductees here tonight, Mr. James McDonald.
Yeah, James. James is, I gave him a cow because Alan wanted to chop its head off and put it in the freezer.
Did he give you three beans for it?
No.
Actually, this was a nursery rhyme.
You owe me three beans. And so I didn't want to, and she was, her name was Cow. And I said, no, I don't really want Alan to chop a head off. So I said to James, you can have Cow. So one morning about 6 o'clock on a freezing cold morning, there's a bash on the door, and James comes running in and says, quick, cow's carving. I thought, oh, beautiful, here we go. So out I go and see Cow calf, and about a week later, Alan said, oh, Cow's had a calf. And James goes, yeah. And Alan said, oh, what did you call it? He said calf. So Cow had calf. And I think she lived for quite a few years too, and he looked after her, so I thank him for that.
He certainly did. Hey, listen, one thing about James, you had a lot of female apprentices. He must have been pretty special to get amongst the crew.
Yeah, well, he was young enough to get amongst the crew then. I don't think I'd let him amongst them now, but
Alan always said to me he was something special. He always showed that very early on. I know we're going to come to him later.
Yeah, well, he was a great kid, James, like he still is a great kid to me. And he was riding work at 11 years old, and he could hold everything on the place. And I remember Alan was saying one day he was riding around the track with him, and this thing was pulling, and he said to James, he said, "Oh, are you okay, okay?" And James goes, "Yes."
Beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, Linda Jones has come all the way out from Australia to be with us tonight. Former, well, current inductee, of course. You never lose it. Linda Jones. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we move to our second inductee. And it's a special racehorse, a horse that I remember winning its maiden at Rotorua over 1,900 metres. Won its maiden at Rotorua over 1,900 metres. The horse was Let's Elope.
Hindsight is wonderful and frustrating. Let's Elope was the second Melbourne Cup winner to pass through Dave O'Sullivan's stables. Yet the Hall of Fame trainer didn't prepare the courageous chestnut for her biggest race. O'Sullivan says she was the best through the sales ring at the Trentham Magic Millions in 1989. By Nasipur out of Sharon Jane and bred by Highview Studs Brent Gillivick, the filly was bought for $16,000 by the Flighter family. O'Sullivan took charge of her training. However, her three-year-old form didn't meet the high expectations. The best results from six races with Wexford Stable were a Group 3 win at Palmerston North and a third in a Group 1 at Ellerslie. That mixed form and a failure to recognise Let's Elope's preference for left-handed racecourses saw her sold to Dennis Marks and Kevin White. She went into the stables of Melbourne Cup legend Bart Cummings, where the key to her success was found. Let's Elope only raced on left-handed tracks. The fourth start across the Tasman, producing a win in the Group 2 Turnbull Stakes. It kicked off a remarkable seven-race winning streak. Next was the Caulfield Cup.
Let's Elope down the outside. Royal Creation and Ivory Way from Let's Elope. It's Royal Creation, Ivory Way and Let's Elope. They hit the line photo. Let's Elope on the outside, perhaps, perhaps.
That was followed by the McKinnon Stakes.
Let's Elope in front of Superimposed and Let's Elope will win it by a length and a half.
And on to the 1991 Melbourne Cup.
And Let's Elope answers, this magnificent mare dashes to the front from Ivory Way and then Superimposed, but it's a great double for Let's Elope. Let's Elope goes on a wizard by three lengths.
Let's Elope became the first mare in more than 50 years to complete Australia's famous Cups double. She didn't stop there, returning in the new year for the Orr and St George Stakes. The VRC Australian Cup was also claimed in a course record time. A fetlock injury then cut her season short, but Let's Elope had the 1992 Horse of the Year award in the cabinet. She returned to the track as a five-year-old and won a match race at Caulfield with eight-time Group 1 winner Better Loosen Up. She was scratched from the Melbourne Cup due to a wet track and embarked on an overseas career with mixed results. In the Japan Cup, she ran unsuccessfully and bled. Let's Elope went to the United States to continue her career under Ron McAnally. She won a minor race on debut and was relegated to third in a Group 1. But bleeding problems and a fractured cannon bone forced her retirement at the end of 1993. After a stint at stud in the States, she went back to Australia. Staff at Victoria's Lauriston Park still talk about Let's Elope with great fondness, saying she always loved a pat from the many fans who visited the farm. At stud, she visited some of the world's greatest stallions. The most successful of her progeny were stakes winners Ustinov and Outback Joe. Let's Elope's track record is outstanding. 26 starts for 11 wins, four of them Group 1s, with career earnings of more than $3.1 million. It earned her induction into the Australian Racing Hall of Fame in 2012. It's fitting that this Kiwi mare gets the recognition she deserves in New Zealand.
Ladies and gentlemen, we thank all our sponsors here tonight and sponsored Let's Elope Majestic Horse Floats, represented by CEO Ward Austin. We'd ask Ward to step forward. And of course, the man who bred A dream come true, I reckon, for Brent Gilovic breeding a Melbourne Cup Queen. Outstanding stuff. And Brent, well, as I said in that intro there, breeding a Melbourne Cup winner. I mean, it must be very special on your CV.
Yeah, no, great thrill that day, that's for sure.
Tell us a little bit of the background with Sharon Jane. How did you acquire her?
I went out to Phil Bailey's to buy a mare. I think it was a Telegraph winner. It might have been placed, and didn't particularly like it much. And this chestnut mare was over there in the paddock, and I asked him what that was, and he said, Sharon Jane. I said, well, throw it in, and I'll take the two. And that's what happened.
Okay, very expensive?
I think it was 100 grand the pair.
Oh, well, that is pretty good money. Now, you chose Nassapur. What did you like about Nassapur?
Well, we took a share in him and with old Keith Wright, and I think he sold too many shares in the end, but we managed to breed two. We actually bred another one to a horse called Grooming, who also won a Group 1 race.
Let's elope herself. You start thinking about great wins. You got the Melbourne Cup. You got the Caulfield Cup. You've got the McKinnon Stakes, you've got the Australian Cup. Did you know that no horse ever has won that quartet?
Oh, I could imagine. It's difficult enough, you know, to win Caulfield Melbourne Cup double. She was the first one in 50 years, and I think Ethereal's done it since, and that might be the only one.
Did you go over to see her win the Melbourne Cup?
No, we have a Melbourne Cup party called the Centennial Club, and by the time they run the cup, we're probably lucky to see it. For that particular year, the New Zealand Herald came along and took a photo of us all, because Timmy Bodle used to bring along the bicentennial Melbourne Cup, and Trevor Knowles, who was our patron, he had the centennial Melbourne Cup. So this party had two Melbourne Cups present, and I think that day we made the front page of the Herald. The next day, there was five of us drunk and disorderly with our photo.
Were you surprised that, you know, Bart Cummings and the connections decided to run, take the horse to Australia? Because she was going okay with Dave, wasn't she?
Yeah, I don't know. You'd have to ask Dave why he let her go. But also, they bought another horse, which we bred as well, which was Richfield Lady, who won the VRC Oaks and a number of other races. That I think we had seven Group 1s at spring for those two horses.
She led a pretty neat life, didn't she, Let's Elope? She died pretty old, didn't she?
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah, and we had the old Sharon Jane till she finished up Broodmare of the Year, and she we paraded her at Ellerslie one day in a it was some horse function, we paraded her. She was quite old, but she looked magic, you know. And Let's Elope was pretty much similar type to her.
Apart from Euston off, it, I suppose it's quite a bit disappointing in some respects that she didn't sort of breed on.
Oh, that's pretty typical of those real good mares. It's generally their daughters. Yeah.
Okay, well, congratulations. I mean, it must be a huge thrill to see her inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Absolutely. You know, Hall of Fame in Australia is a big thing, and it's fantastic that she's recognised here in New Zealand.
Oh, it's great stuff. Well, good on you, Brent. We'll ask Ward to make the presentation to you now. Let's elope, ladies and gentlemen, our second inductee of the night. And there's no truth in the rumour that Brent Gilovic and I were separated at birth. We get muddled up a lot, you know.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the moustache. It's growing on me, but... Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to move to our third inductee. And it is one horse that you're all aware of, the wonderfully named Mufasa.
Just a small selection from the amazing record of Mufasa. He won 10 Group 1s for the owner, who epitomised a passionate racegoer. David Archer admits that he was a bit green in the sales ring when he purchased Mufasa in 2006 for $50,000. 2 years earlier, he'd bought Beljoie, Mufasa's half-sister. Archer reasoned that if he could run as fast as Beljoie with the superior sire in Pentire, he was worth a go. He went to Stephen McKee's stables and bonded with strapper Amy Doran. She sought inspiration for his name from the Lion King movie. McKee's superstitions encouraged Archer to make it a seven-letter name, adding an F to Mufasa, or Murph for short. The royal tendencies stayed with Mufasa. He knew he was special, always demanding attention. The racing ability was apparent from the early training days. McKee was quick to tell Archer that he'd made a great purchase. Mufasa loved to run. He won his first race at Whangarei as a two-year-old, with an amazing time of 56 seconds over 1,000 metres. The results were mixed in the three-year-old season at the midway point, until Mufasa was diagnosed with a major back problem. Once remedied, he returned to win three in a row, raising thoughts about how much better that season could have been. The injury-free four-year-old season was a revelation. Mufasa won his first Group 2 in the Copeland's Bakery, and then two Group 1s back-to-back, the Telegraph and the Waikato Sprint. A trip across the Tasman helped forge another special bond with jockey Sam Spratt. They would combine for 40 of Mufasa's 62 races. Back as a six-year-old, Mufasa repeated his double success in the Telegraph and Waikato Sprint. It guaranteed the Horse of the Year title for the second time. Three more Group 1s followed in his seventh season, two of them in Australia, Mufasa breaking the Oz barrier in the Toorak and Futurity. His 10th and final Group 1 win was in Hawke's Bay, the stunning 8-year-old winning the Windsor Park Plate.
But Mufasa, that is a perfect 10 Group 1 victories! What an amazing racehorse! He's been too good for them!
His 8 New Zealand Group 1s and 2 Australian Group 1s were all significant. Yet owner David Archer says the race that showed his true character was his gutsy second after surgery in the George Ryder.
Happy trails, head of the straight, King Mufasa led. He's being nursed along at the moment, led from Veyron. Piero starting to put in the big ones down the centre. Fotolina getting up on the inside. King Mufasa still in front. Now Piero Gunda starting to run on strongly down the outside. King Mufasa in front. Piero's lifting on the outside. He draws level, and Piero, slipper 1 year, right of the next, goes on to win it from King Mufasa. Third maybe.
Mufasa went to Hong Kong to contest the Group 1 Champions Mile. Unfortunately, he finished last after swallowing his tongue. That setback was overcome, and Mufasa returned to defend his Windsor Park Plate as a 9-year-old. He ran a gallant second. In December of 2013, Mufasa pulled up lame after a track work gallop. An examination revealed bone damage. David Archer announced the time had come for Murph to retire. He still lived the life of a king at the owner's Karaka home, a property Archer attributed to the success of his champion. Murph couldn't be separated from strapper Amy Doran. They regularly competed in pony shows and as a pin-up boy for Ellerslie Racing. Mufasa was always ready for a guest star role at major races. His career record shows 62 races for 20 wins, 10 of them Group 1s, with 10 Group 1 placings. His stakes were more than $3.6 million. David Archer had much to be grateful for the amazing journey that Mufasa took his family on.
Mufasa's been fantastic to us. He's given us a life that you wouldn't otherwise have. We're just so grateful to see him win this race, whatever else he might do, to win one more at 8 years of age. Puts him on a special stage. So, Mufasa, we love you and thank you for that.
Come here, come this side here, because I'll talk to you first. I'll talk to Di a little later on. She can correct you. David, I got to say, let's look at the camera there. Work the camera. David, I watched the inductee videos before tonight, and even I choked up a little when I listened to you make that speech at the end of Hawke's Bay.
Yeah, it was pretty special. He was a very special horse. How lucky you are to have a horse that, and others have enjoyed it too, that won from 2-year-old to 8, nearly won at 9. He ran in 39 Group 1 races, and he was 20 times in the first three. He did that over that period of time, including back injury, really bad hoof ailments throughout his time. Amy Duran's with us. She looked after those hooves, and he had an entrapment problems through his life. And you did touch on that in the video there, the Piero race. And Piero by Gay Waterhouse was at that stage said to be the best horse in Australia in 100 years. 2 weeks prior, this is, Mufi was a warrior. 2 weeks prior to that, he entrapped badly. And so he sent him into the clinic in Sydney, and he went for a general anaesthetic operation, and they rang us back and said, geez, he's amazing. He stood up straight after the operation. Keep training him. So we put him back to training. A week later, he re-entrapped. So Amy took him down to the clinic and held him while he had a local anaesthetic. He got fixed again. He went to the racetrack, threw a shoe in the birdcage, took him back to the farrier, course farrier, put a new shoe on, stuck a nail through his foot, and that horse got beaten by a head by Piero. Now, that would have been a hell of a run.
I can see now why you thought it was the best run. I could never work it out. 10 group ones, you go to one where he gets beaten.
Yeah, right. Yeah, very, very fortunate, but a lovely warrior he was.
Beljoire wasn't a slug either. Won 5 or 6?
She won 6, I think, and she was very gritty. You're quite right. This lovely lady here joined my life after Beljoire, but as we both were together when we bought Mufasa, and it was exactly that. We have a man over here, John Thompson, and of course Colin Thompson and Irene, who have become very, very strong friends with Colleen, and they sold us the horse, and when we saw it by Pentire, exactly as that clip said, we thought, if he's 2 lengths better than Beljoire, he'll be all right.
Hey, listen, Di, he must have been a good-looking yearling. That's David. About there.
When he arrived back at the McKee Stables, David, we went out to see him, and David walked past him and round the stables, and I said, that's the horse we've bought. And David goes, no, no, no. So he keeps going around the stables, and Stephen looked at him, and he said, we came back to this horse. I said, that is the horse we bought. And he goes, oh, my God, it is. So that's had a good eye it's got.
So you are green. I love you coming to my auctions. Love you coming. Dave, I just want to ask one thing. You have a relationship too with Brendan Lindsay. Who got who into racing?
Yeah, well, Brendan. Yeah, Brendan is a very close friend. And I had been racing horses in my earlier life, and unfortunately I lost my wife from cancer when she was 50. And I stopped racing horses. In fact, Sunline was the horse that sort of I kept coming back to watch during that period. And so we stopped racing horses. Diane came into my life, and she, as you guys know, was part of Redoubt Park and Keith Wright and quite a racing heritage. But I'd stopped racing. So Brendan Lindsay came to me, and Brendan's got a very strong personality, right? And he said to me, David, he said, come on, come to the sales. I said, no, Hank, his nickname's Hanger. Not male comment, he made hangers.
Plastic coat hangers, ladies and gentlemen, plastic coat hangers, yeah.
So anyway, so Hanger said to me, come on, David, out the sales. No, I turned him down about 6 or 7 times trying to play hard to get. And he said, come on. So I said, okay, I'll come out, but I'm not buying anything. So I went out and I came home with 3.5. One was Galleon's Reach, and that started me back.
And it's been an absolute pleasure to have you back. Di and David, enjoy tonight. Thank you. David Archer, Di Wright, John Thompson, Ritual Stud. Watch the steps, John, going down. Those who are here at the Thoroughbred Breeders will know he disappeared off the stage the last time he exited the stage. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to our last inductee of this session, and a special one it is. He is a person that, well, one of my highlights on trackside, I labelled him my horse to follow. I refer to, of course, James McDonald.
James McDonald had the determination to succeed from a young age. Ironically, riding wasn't initially on the radar. He wanted to be a dairy farmer. But when McDonald jumped on a saddle, his natural ability was soon obvious. McDonald learned to ride through hunting as a 10-year-old. 6 weeks later, he was jumping wire fences. It gave him a good grounding for the challenges ahead. He had a reputation for being fearless and brave, with the innate ability to get the best out of the toughest horses. He first excelled on the show jumping circuit. But the kid from Kaipaki was destined for something bigger on the race course. It started when he was sent across the road to ride track work for Alan and Linda Jones at age 14. McDonald balanced school life with riding commitments. He rode at the trials until the start of the new racing season in 2007. He was an instant success on the racetrack. McDonald won the Apprentice of the Year title and claimed a Group 1 victory in his first season. The awards and accolades kept coming. McDonald won the Apprentice title four times and three jockey premierships. In the 2010-11 season, he became the first jockey to pass 200 wins. His record of 207 remained undefeated at the time of his induction into the Racing Hall of Fame. From early in his apprenticeship, McDonald set his sights on riding overseas. He seized opportunities in Hong Kong, Ireland, England, Singapore, and many other places to gain valuable experience, swiftly adapting to the local styles of riding. It paid off with Group 1 success in Hong Kong and winners for the Queen during Royal Ascot. The young Kiwi took it in his stride, never fussing about the pomp and ceremony. All that success prompted a frequent question: what made McDonald so good? He says it's about doing the homework, understanding his horse in every race, learning about the competitors, knowing the other jockeys. McDonald said that preparation made him very aware and helped him read a race intuitively. Those skills are important to McDonald's success, but he also acknowledged the supporters who helped him on the ride to the top of his profession. One important mentor was Sir Peter Vella. McDonald regards the Group 1 Telegraph Handicap win on Sir Peter's horse Giuseppina as one of his most memorable. By the end of 2012, McDonald was ready for a move to Sydney. It didn't take long to make an impact. He claimed Australia's Triple Crown with victory on It's a Done Deal in the ATC Derby.
It's a Done Deal chiming in, and the Pocket Rocket from New Zealand claim them in a stride, and It's a Done Deal race to the front at the 200 metre mark. This is an exercise gallop. He's moving away for one of the most impressive wins you'll ever see in the Derby. It's a Done Deal, and a hand canter wins it by five lengths.
By the following year, he had won two of Australia's biggest races, the Golden Slipper and the Queen Elizabeth Stakes, and topped the Sydney Riders Premiership.
Moth Fun's kicking back on the inside. Earthquake's dying in a run, and Moth Fun! Moth Fun right along the rail has won it from Earthquake.
And what a great thrill for a young rider in James McDonald. He has the world at his feet, and he wins one of the classic races in Australia.
But on the outside, It's a Done Deal has run to the front. Sacred Falls is coming after him. He's coming fast, but It's a Done Deal is hanging on grimly. He peaks when it counts. It's a Done Deal beat Sacred Falls and Carlton House.
He was regarded as one of the best jockeys in the world and earned a lucrative contract with Sheikh Mohammed's Godolphin Stables. There's often a bump in every champion's career. McDonald's setback came in 2016, when he was suspended for 18 months. The time away from the sport gave him a new appreciation for life and riding. McDonald redeemed himself by returning better than ever. He won the Sydney Premiership for the third time in 2018-19.
And the George Moore Award goes to James McDonald.
At the time, McDonald became the youngest inductee into the Racing Hall of Fame. No one expected it to be a swan song. There were still plenty of goals for the 29-year-old and many more races to win around the world.
Before we have a chat with James, these days he does a lot of riding for another champion New Zealander, Chris Waller, and Chris spent a little bit of time thinking about tonight.
Good evening, everybody. What a great event this is. And being into the Hall of Fame is something extremely special, and I certainly know this recipient will be very proud. I'm certainly proud to be sponsoring the induction, and there's no more worthy recipient than James McDonald. James is a tireless worker, and for his age, what he's achieved in such a short time is quite remarkable. He's got the respect of his peers, he's got the respects of investors in the industry, and he's got the respect of obviously so many people and what's an amazing, amazing industry. And I certainly think that James will not only be proud of this award, but he'll certainly carry it with him with honour, as it should be. And he'll certainly be around for a lot longer and riding a lot of winners. I've been lucky enough to be able to work with him firsthand, and I can certainly say he's a meticulous person. He looks after, obviously, his health. He respects the horses that he rides. He's a great horseman. And, well, what he's achieved and what he's going to achieve is very special. Well done, James.
That bloke's a special man in your life today, James.
Yeah, he's a Beaker supporter. Can't really do too much without him, to be fair, but he's been a wonderful mentor as well as many trainers back home.
James, you know, when you came back, everybody knows that you're riding better than ever. It was people like Chris Waller that gave you the support that you were looking for.
Yeah, well, he's been dominating Sydney for so long, or Australia for so long, and being a fellow Kiwi, I suppose he felt obligated to help me out a little bit, even though we've probably haven't ridden every horse so good, but we've had some wonderful, wonderful moments together, and hopefully many more. But we've been so lucky with the champion sprinter that we've associated with the champion stayer, and yeah, he's just a champion bloke who just wears his heart on his sleeve and gives me every opportunity.
Before we have a look back on your career, let's just sort of talk about what's happening right now. I mean, just the other day, 100 wins for the season in New South Wales. That's three times you've done that. So is Darren Beeben, so is Larry Cassidy. They're pretty big shoes to fill in themselves, aren't they, really? But you're riding the crest of the wave at the moment.
Yeah, we're having a good run, but like that man there and John O'Shea, who's been a massive supporter of mine since I moved over, and he was probably the one that got me to ship up and move over, and he gave us all his backing, even when owners probably weren't so confident in that particular time, and he was a rock to me, and yeah, so at the moment we're reaping the rewards, but it's Fast Horse has definitely helped that.
Fastest jockey to ride 50 Group 1s too in a season. I mean, that's a pretty special thing to have on your CV as well, my friend.
Yeah, no, it's amazing, but yeah, it's just the people that helped me.
Well, I'm going to pick up something that Linda said before too, because I'll go back a long, long time with Linda as a tour lead on the Melbourne Cup. Linda and I, we used to do this tour a lot, and she actually basically said this, and she did say it tonight too with Steve. She talked about the fact that there was this young fellow who was riding horses around the place, probably a cow or two as well, at the stable, and he's about 11 or 12, but trust me, he's going to be a very, very good jockey. And I said, I remember saying this to Linda, these sorts of things you never forget. I remember saying to Linda, how good this kid's got the X factor, dears, you watch. And she was proven right. And Linda and Alan, they started the ball rolling for you in some way, didn't they?
Yeah, I learnt on their horses. I actually fell off one of his good ones in Linksky and never got back on it in that end. But he was a big supporter, and he used to love his grass, and we used to gallop our ponies up there, not that he knew. And one day he caught us and chased us off with a tractor, me and my brother. So we had wonderful times, and he always wanted it. Well, at that particular time, there was a pony race up at Ellerslie back then, and we used to try and find the smallest racehorse, but never could find one small enough, and the one got close by Lake Coniston, but that was about it.
What about some of the jockeys you rode against in New Zealand, guys that you looked up to? I mean, I read something recently that you yourself honoured to be inducted in the Hall of Fame alongside these great names like Shane Dye, Lance O'Sullivan and James and Jimmy Cassidy and the like. Are they the sort of jockeys that became role models for you?
Yeah, for sure. I was first time I ever met Lance, who was at the sales, and I was too scared to go up and see him, and all I wanted to be is a dairy farmer, and I just wanted to know how he bought his first farm and what age was it, and it's 19 and I'm still trying to buy my first one, so I'm struggling a bit, Lani, but yeah, it's It's been amazing, especially Shane Dye, who's he was the king back then, and you just look up to those guys for sure. I used to have pictures on their wall, Lance and Shane and Darren Beedman, so it's quite amazing.
Well, you've ridden so many winners this season, as we all know, but $17 million in stake money, you can probably afford to buy a better place in Double Bay or Vaucluse or one of those sorts of places in Sydney right now. I suppose you've got a good property, have you?
Yeah, Batley Way.
Batley Way. Tell us what this really means to you, being inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Oh, it's just amazing. I never thought it would come. But
James, I don't think any words are needed. Emotion says it all. You're a humble person, and I know you've got something else to say.
I just want to thank my mum and dad, and Sir Peter Bella, who it's been amazing through the dark times, and obviously when I got in trouble, and we've enjoyed so much success together. So thank you so much.
We love you, mate. We love you.
Come this way, Bruce, if you bring James, just come back this way, take a photo opportunity with Bruce there. twins. Don't go away, James, because we've got a special thing to auction, and it is your whip. This is the whip you rode your 50th Group 1 on.
It's the right one too.
I know it's the right one. You've signed the back. Gracie Taylor's here. I'm going to ask Cherry Taylor, my lovely wife, Natalie Davis, to come up and be the spotters. There we are. And James, you can bid spot in front, okay? All right? How much do you think it's worth?
I don't know.
See how we go. All right, you sound like most of my vendors. See how you go. Lady, here, do your best. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the whip, and you know the career of James McDonald is still rolling on. Ladies and gentlemen, the 50th Group 1 for James McDonald. What would you pay to have that on your wall? Is there 4,000 or 5,000? Is there 3? Is there 2? Is there $1,000? 1,000, thank you. One bid. One. 1,500. 1,500, 2,000, 2,500 there, 3 there, 3,000, 5,000, 4,000 at the back, 4,000, 5 here, 5, 6,000, $6,000 enamel to 6,000, $6,000 enamel to 6,000, 7 here, 7, 8 here now, $8,000 enamel to 8,000, enamel to 8,000, I took it here to Natalie, 9,000, not 10, thank you, $10,000 enamel to 10, 11, 11,000, 12, he's lefty, oh, I wish you'd come to all my auctions. I always say that, leave your hand in the air and I'll tell you when to break it down. 12,000, 12 here, $12,000 in Everett, $12,000 in Everett, 12. How am I going, James?
You're going all right.
13, 14, 14,000, lost my... 14,000, $14,000 in Everett, 14,000, I'm going to sell right. It's a one only. At 14,000, I'm going to... 15, 16... I hope you don't want to go to the toilet. 16,000, is that right? We're at 16? 16 here. 16,000. At 16,000, I'm going to sell. 17, 18. 18,000, I reckon you go 19, the hand's still in the air. I'm just saying, 18,000. What do you say, one more? What do you think, 18,000? At 18,000, I'm going to sell it. How am I going now?
Yeah, good.
20 here, 21 here. 21 the age we'd like to be. 21 here, 21,000. Want to be two little ducks? His hand's still up, 21. But don't be throwing your hand up, people. He might bring it down. At 21,000, I'm going to sell. I sell to the right. I sell for 21,000. Mr. Tony Ryder, Milan Park. Well done here. One last word?
No.
That's it. At least we put a smile on your face, my friend. James McDonald, ladies and gentlemen. a superstar.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce, representing New Zealand Thoroughbred Racing, NZTR, it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage Mr. Bruce Sharrock. Bruce Sharrock, Deputy Chairperson, New Zealand Thoroughbred Racing. Thanks, Bruce.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, everyone. Bit of a hard act to follow with James, unfortunately. I'll bring the tone down somewhat. Firstly, a couple of apologies. Our Chief Executive, Bernard Saundry, has shot across the ditch to, I guess, cuddle his first granddaughter. So he shot off, I think, late this week. And Cameron George, our chairman, unfortunately can't be here. He wrestled with the Warriors to get to another 2 points tonight. So you've got me. Look, I think, where do I start? I guess very, very briefly, the last year's been somewhat interesting, challenging for the industry as a whole. I came onto the board in, September of 2019, and we went through the process of the new Act, which I think has been really, really good for where we want to head. Then we fell into a little thing called COVID, and that sort of upset the apple cart somewhat. But to credit to everyone, I think the industry has come through in very good shape. There's a number of positive green shoots that are coming out now. I think the performance of the TAB, the restructure of the TAB, has certainly shone some light of optimism for us all going forward. From a board's point of view and an industry point of view, we've worked very hard to try and, I guess, simplify what we need to do. And I think, quite frankly, what we need to do is make some long-needed change. And it's probably going to challenge a little bit of thinking over the course of time. But I think it's well needed. And personally, I'm looking forward to it. But I think more than ever, it's about action now. I think there's been a lot of words through the generations. And for now, it's about making change so that every stakeholder and people in this room that have contributed so richly over decades and decades can see this industry once again up where it should be. And it was mentioned earlier, rugby, racing and beer. We need to be back up there as part of that three. On to tonight. What an amazing occasion. It's a privilege on behalf of NZTR to be in a room with so many people that have given their life, have contributed so richly to this industry. And I just think it's an amazing event. NZTR certainly is very proud to be associated and contribute in their small way. The Love Racing team help put together some of the features that you'll see tonight. So look, all in all, I'm not going to steal any more time other than to say to all inductees, what a fantastic achievement, what a fantastic event, and everybody, just enjoy your night, because I think that's what this is all about. Thank you.
Well done. Bruce Sharrock, ladies and gentlemen, the new deputy chairperson of the new New Zealand Thoroughbred Racing. And if the name seems familiar, he is, of course, the brother of Alan Sharrock, and for those with memory long enough, was manager of Michael Walker in the days that he was riding here in New Zealand.
Thank you, Steve. Inductee number 5, ladies and gentlemen, Sir James Fletcher.
Sir James Fletcher has earned a unique place in New Zealand history for being a giant in two major industries, construction and racing. The first was his living, the latter his passion. During Sir James's 70-year racing era, he was an avid rider, a prolific owner, a skilled administrator, president of the country's largest racing club and a stud owner. All achieved while working full-time and running the biggest company in the country. JC, or Jim as he was known by family and friends, was born in Dunedin on Christmas Day in 1914. He was the second son of Sir James Fletcher Sr., the founder of Fletcher Construction. The interest in horses wasn't encouraged by his parents, but that never stopped him. He took riding lessons after leaving school and then rode with the Pakuranga Hunt Club for more than 40 years. He was attracted by the thrill and ritual of the hunt. Moonfleet was his first mount. That was followed by King Rod, which provided him with his first racing success at the age of 22, the Waikato Hunt Cup. Gambling was never part of the allure. He loved the racing environment and the people involved. It was a passion he shared with his wife. Vaughan was an avid racegoer and scrapbooker. She filled 19 books over 70 years, documenting every race meeting and event involving their horses. The races were always on in the household. In 1939, JC and his father bought a rundown dairy farm near Te Kauwhata. They converted it into a stud called Elton Lodge and revolutionised the breeding industry in New Zealand.
A paradise for thoroughbreds. 750 acres of rolling, rich Waikato land. Here, as on other New Zealand stud farms, the rye pasture stays in good heart, for the climate varies only 11 degrees between summer and winter.
The Fletchers' inspiration came from successful farms in America like Claiborne. Elton Lodge was a commercial enterprise. Fences were painted white, glossy full-page adverts were created, and a full-time vet was employed. It took thoroughbred breeding into a new age.
Every modern advance in the technique of breeding is carefully studied by New Zealand breeders. At Elton Lodge, an up-to-date laboratory is maintained for the care and treatment of their valuable stock. Heading the staff is Dr. Murray Bain, a veterinary surgeon of worldwide experience.
The stud was extremely successful in its relatively short 20-year history. The Fletchers topped the Trentham yearling sales in 1951. Balloch ended Foxbridge's 11-year reign as the top sire in the same year. They did it again in 1952 when the Balloch bred Del Rey won the Melbourne Cup.
Del Rey's performance is the greatest for a four-year-old since the immortal Farlap. It takes a champion to win the Melbourne Cup, and Del Rey is a champion. Del Rey gets a tremendous reception.
Balloch topped the Trentham sales again in 1956 and 57.
But pride of Elton Lodge is Balloch by Obliterate, sire of Quashed from Cinna, a world-famous foundation brood mare, and dam of half a dozen successful sires, including Beau Pair and Mr. Standfast.
Elton Lodge's success attracted royalty in the 50s. Balloch and Gold Nib were among the decade's top 10 sires. Yet the dignitaries preferred to see the English Derby winner, Midday Sun. The stud was also the first to promote the live foal guarantee as part of the service fee package. Eventually, JC's livestock passion became too much of a business. The Fletchers closed the lodge as a public stud, and 10 years later, got out of the farm completely. The focus went back to the racetrack, and the Fletcher tartan colours were extremely successful. Loyalty was always important to the Fletchers' racing activities, with first Merv Ritchie and then Dave O'Sullivan entrusted with training their horses. From Teresa's victory in the Tattersall Gold Cup in 1952 to Rustler winning the Wellington Cup in 1973, Sir James's horses performed well at home and abroad. The best was Mr. Tiz. The Hall of Famer won 7 Group 1s, becoming one of the best New Zealand sprinters since World War II. This was Sir James speaking after Mr. Tiz won his second Railway Stakes, a more convincing victory than the dead heat of a year before.
It's a great thrill to win the Railway. This year it was short and swift. Last year I think we had to wait 10 minutes for the result.
It's almost a mystery how Sir James found time to contribute to administration of the racing industry while running New Zealand's largest company. He was a founding member of the New Zealand Thoroughbred Breeders Association. He also worked his way from steward at the Auckland Racing Club to president between 1969 and 1972. The knighthood was awarded in 1980 for Sir James's business achievements. It's fitting that the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame celebrates Sir James Fletcher's vast contribution to the racing industry.
Hugh, did you enjoy that?
That was a brilliantly put together video. Couldn't have done anything like that myself. That was great, Annie.
Thank Very you. Good, Annie. It certainly was. One thing that struck me, and it's something that I learned from it, is the stud was so successful. Why did it close?
Well, it was really that he had this view. He was a business with a global perspective, and he believed that you should in business aspire to be world class and to be the best. And he just felt he couldn't give it the time, And it was also a believer that it's all about combining a natural advantage that New Zealand has in the grass and the climate with what Professor Porter of Harvard would call a cluster, where you get a cluster of individual skills and infrastructure and you just build something superior. And one of the problems was, as an absentee owner, could you bring that stud master excellence? And when you get a great stud master, they naturally wanted to have their own stud. So it was, he couldn't put the human element. You saw there about the vet. You know, he went to America, besides bringing broodmares and stallions from Britain and things, he brought a lot of ideas about how to run the thoroughbred industry from America. And so it was just, he didn't believe he could do it well enough. And if he couldn't do it well enough, he didn't want to do it.
Well, I got to be saying, I'm super impressed that he was able to run both the business side and his passion at the same time. How do you find time?
Well, that was part of the problem and things. This was a time at which he was establishing the newsprint industry in New Zealand, the steel industry in New Zealand, a lot of other pioneering. The first company in the Southern Hemisphere to make ready-mixed concrete. So you're right. I mean, but he still had the passion. He was still hunting, falling off the horse and things, which is a family trait. And
so do you hunt?
I hunted for 50 years, yes.
Do you fall off often?
A lot. I've had so many concussions. You know, you helicopter rides. Nobody's had more free helicopter rides in this country than me. So, yeah.
And you've got some of that passion. Your sons have got that passion as well.
Yes, yes. Well, they do. My son Ned's managed to fall off a few times too. So the only reason my father gave up hunting after only 40 years was he lost his balance. And it didn't need a fence for him to fall off. He'd be walking across the paddock and you'd see him slowly. So again, it was, you know, if you can't do it, you know, well, you shouldn't do it.
Shouldn't do it. Listen, the other thing that sticks out for me, the colours, the Fletcher tartan.
Well, I said to James McDonald earlier, look, my wife and I have had horses for 40 years and we haven't yet won a Group 1.
You haven't had James?
Exactly. Could James please come and ride one of my horses?
I'm sure we can arrange that for 21,000. He'll bring the whip. You can keep the whip after the race. Hugh, I've got to say congratulations and well done for the Fletcher family and all the best for the future. Hugh Fletcher, ladies and gentlemen, Poole Wilcox to present.
Starcraft inductee number 6, sponsored by Waikato Stud, of course bred by Waikato Stud, Gary Chittick and Mark Chittick, would you please come forward.
Globetrotter is an apt moniker for the international success of Starcraft. He won 5 Group 1s in 4 countries, a milestone that's rarely been repeated. Starcraft's early years were at Waikato Stud. The gangly chestnut yearling by Soviet Star at a Flying Flossie was sold at the 2002 Karaka sales for $80,000. Keen racegoer Paul Macon sent him to the Australian stables of Gary Newham. For the long-time trainer, Starcraft was his best by far. The 2-year-old showed potential with placings in his first 2 starts. But it was in his 3-year-old season where Starcraft really stamped his mark. He took out a maiden race in his 2nd start back. The wins continued, 4 in a row, culminating in the Group 3 Debonair. The summer of 2004 went from amazing to outstanding in the blink of an eye. Starcraft claimed his first Group 1 win in the Chipping Norton. Next was the Group 2 Tulloch. The most dazzling performance came with Starcraft's impressive speed in the Australian Derby.
From Del Zio, Starcraft on the outside, races up to Braylock. Starcraft and Braylock, the two of them go to the line. Starcraft on the outside, or Braylock, and a terrific finish.
For trainer Gary Newham, it was a dream come true.
No, the Derby was the highlight of everything in my life. It was a dream to just come true.
The accolades flowed. Australian champion three-year-old for that stunning season. Nicknamed Plod around the stables, Newham wanted to showcase StarCraft's talents in his birthplace. The Kiwi public welcomed StarCraft home as he chased Group 1 glory during the Hawke's Bay Spring Racing Carnival. Bigger and stronger as a four-year-old, StarCraft didn't disappoint his fans.
StarCraft, he's about to fly the last little bit. Miss Potential, StarCraft is absolutely flying. Amazing performance, StarCraft.
He returned to Australia with a swag of trophies. The Group 1 Mudgeway, Group 2 Stony Bridge, and a second in the Celt Capital Stakes. He was also awarded New Zealand's Champion Older Sprinter title. By the 2004 Melbourne Spring Carnival, StarCraft was the favourite for the Cox Plate. He had to settle for third, but it didn't dampen his owner's plans for a worldwide campaign. The chestnut was taken to Great Britain in the summer of 05, where he was trained by Luca Kumani. The five-year-old surprised many European race fans with his dominant victory in the Prix de Milan in Paris.
The final 300, it's all the way so far for StarCraft and Christophe Lemaire. Whipper gallantly trying to run on in second position, then comes Cacique. Guerrella's making up ground late, as indeed is Major's Cast, but up towards the line, it's StarCraft out in front, Guerrella and Major's Cast. StarCraft gets it. Guerrella...
Proving it was no fluke, StarCraft then took out the Group 1 Queen Elizabeth II Stakes. It was his 11th win from 22 starts and his fifth Group 1 success. The 2005 world champion Older Turf Miler then turned his attention to the United States. Despite never racing on a dirt track, the owners paid $800,000 to enter the $4 million Breeders' Cup Classic. Drawing an outside barrier, and getting away to a slow start, StarCraft finished seventh in a 13-horse field. StarCraft was retired the following year, serving his first group of mares at Cheveley Park Stud in England. He later returned to Australia to stand at Arrowfield Stud. He sired Group 1 winners Star Witness, and we can say it now. The charismatic sire's progeny continue to be keenly sought after at Victoria's Rosemount Stud. StarCraft's track record speaks for itself, a 50% winning strike rate and earnings of $3.2 million. On top of the five Group 1 races in four countries, StarCraft certainly earns his induction into the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame.
Gary's very proud, I dare say. You know, you've been up here, you've had lots of accolades with your champion nursery in Waikato Stud. Mark, you must be feeling quite proud about StarCraft being inducted as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he was an incredible horse, and, you know, Paul Macon certainly wanted to take on the world, and he knew he had an animal and athlete that could do that, and away he went. You've got to take your hat off to him.
You've bred so many Group 1 winners, you and Gary, over the years, and they've won in all sorts of countries. This horse has won Group 1s in four different countries, and that's almost unheard of, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely, and obviously we're very proud when any horse that comes off the farm wins a Group 1, but certainly when StarCraft went to France and England, and I remember getting a photo from a girl that had done a yelling prep for us, and she said I couldn't be more proud. She was at Ascot when he won the Queen Elizabeth Stakes and sent a photo of that WS back in the parade ring, you know, and so it was pretty cool.
Absolutely. Tell us about the start, Flying Floozy. What was she like as a racehorse, first of all, and as a breedmare overall?
Big, ugly, and really slow.
How slow? Did she win a race?
No, she couldn't win a race. I think the closest she got was about third at Te Rapa in the middle of the winter one day.
So what made you keep her?
It's a very good family. She is from a very, very good family, and we probably didn't have a lot of the family at the time, so that was the reason for keeping her.
How did the Soviet Star mating come about? I mean, he only came out to Haunui, didn't he, just for 1 year?
Yeah, that's right. No, we put about a sort of a solid week's work into the pedigree and the mix and all that. No, we didn't at all. Gary said to me one day, "You better, those Haunui boys are looking after us pretty well. You better get it sorted out of mare to go to Soviet Star." And I said, "Oh, crikey, really? What? What do we need?" And he goes, "He's not that big. Just send a big one." So that's how he was made.
Well, there you go. You see, did she went on and she left another good horse, didn't she?
Yeah. She left three stakes winners in the end, and sort of it was a bit of a shame in the end. Bruce Perry rang me one day and offered us a lot of money on behalf of an Australian client. We had three fillies out of her, so we sold her in folded pins, and she was in fold a little bit late, and unfortunately she aborted that fold, damaged her cervix, and they sent her overseas to try and fix that. They got her in fold of Galileo, and then they did a caesarean, and they lost the fold, the mare. Everything was a disaster.
Shame. Well, Starcraft, after he finished racing, and I guess there would have been a whole lot of competition out there wanting to get Starcraft to stand at stud. I mean, because you guys started the ball rolling, were you in the running?
Look, yeah, we really like the horse, and I honestly, we do believe very strongly that he would have been an even more successful stallion in New Zealand. We believe he would have actually suited the New Zealand mares a lot better than the Australian mares, but... And I Paul Macon, he was pretty sort of out there, sort of a rooster, and he's one of those lucky people that knew everything, you know. And he and his family came and stayed on one of the nights just before the Hawke's Bay race, you know. And they'd been cooked this lovely roast and this, that and the other thing, and was drinking our wine, and it was all a really nice evening, and we sort of dropped a few hints about this and about him, you know, maybe making his way to Waikato Stud, and he told us plainly that Waikato Stud, you know, wasn't up to where Starcraft was going to be living, so therefore he didn't get any dessert.
He got that wrong. He got that totally wrong. Finally, I think we should pay credit to a man that put up his hand and bought the horse for 80 grand, Robert Dorr.
Absolutely. Robert, he does a hell of a lot of study. We tried to get Robert here tonight, but he had something on down south. But he does a hell of a lot of study on his horses. And a lot of his study is not with the catalogue. He goes and picks what he believes is an athlete out. And, you know, Gary Newham said there on that video that Starcraft was a big sort of gangly sort of a chap most of his life, really. And certainly when he was a yearling, he was that way. So... what Robert saw on him, I don't know, but good on him. He picked him, and he'd had a previous association with Macon, and they'd had many years apart. He was another one that had fallen out with Paul, but then Paul gave him another chance to buy a horse, and he bought Starcraft.
That's a great story. Well, congratulations again, guys. You always breed champions. You've bred one here, and he deserves to be in the Hall of Fame, no question about it. I mean, now your dad's going to make a presentation to you because he's a sponsor of Starcraft. So shake hands.
We're only here because Robert's not here.
Shake hands and take a photograph. Ladies and gentlemen, a great inductee, Starcraft.
I reckon that'd have been one dinner to have been at. Gary Chittick and Paul Macon.
Yes, no dessert, eh? All right, let's look at inductee number 7 here, Steve, Tommy George.
Tommy George was a horseman with many feathers in his cap. He was a jockey, owner, trainer, stud master, and excelled in each profession. He held the trainer premiership record with 9 for half a century, only eclipsed by the O'Sullivan era in the 1990s. Thomas Reginald George was born in Adelaide in 1887, but moved to Wellington at a young age with his family. He started his career as a jockey, riding mostly in the South Island over 15 years, where he clocked up 150 wins. He turned his hand to training in 1915. That was in Palmerston North, where he had a contract with the local MP, David Buick, to train his horses. George's breakthrough came in the late 1920s, when he moved to Blenheim and worked privately for the mayor and farming identity, John Joseph Corrie. The Corrie-George combination achieved remarkable success, producing many winners, with Synagogue, Rabbi and Croupier the standout performers. That success spurred George to solo at Trentham. George didn't do things by halves. The Brentwood training stables were twice the size of his competition, able to house more than 25 horses. His theory was, the more horses you have, the more you'll win. It paid off. In the 1934-35 season, George became the first New Zealand trainer to produce more than 50 winners, breaking his own record of 47. George won four Auckland Cups in 7 years, two of them with the great mare and Hall of Famer Cuddle, who he trained for most of her career. Another one of his best horses was Beau Veet. The trainer fell in love with the colt at the yearling sales and encouraged wealthy businessman Ralph Stewart to buy him. Broken in by George, Beau Veet was a superstar in the years before and during World War II. He won 31 races, including another Auckland Cup, a Great Northern Derby, as well as two Cox Plates and two McKinnon Stakes. George never got the credit for the Australian wins. They were listed under Randwick trainer Frank McGrath. There was still a Brentwood Stables connection in the victory's races. Beau Veet was a one-man horse. He would only be handled by Brentwood foreman Joe Bromby. The fiery champion was extremely lucky to escape an assassination attempt ahead of the 1940 Melbourne Cup. Beau Veet was a strong favourite to win, just like the Kiwi great Far Lap in 1930. Holes were bored in the stable wall under the cover of darkness and a thunderstorm, and a horse was shot twice. The bullets were meant for Beau Veet. Instead, the gangsters got the wrong box and shot a horse called El Galia. Both were brown horses wearing white bridles and red rugs with white bandages on their hind legs. Beau Veet's box was 18 metres away. Death threats were also made against the jockey, and police mounted an around-the-clock guard. In the end, Beau Veet finished a close fourth in the Cup.
And on the outside, old Roly with the white bridle is making light of his 7 years. He passes Boleve, while Mike Eye with the dark jacket out wide is putting in his claim. But it's old Roly from Mike Eye with Tidal Wave with the light jacket coming through fast to take third place.
A reward was offered, but the attackers were never found. George moved away from training during World War II when the Trentham racecourse was taken over by the military and turned into an army camp. By that stage, George had accumulated an incredible record. 7 trainer premierships during the 1930s and 2 in the first seasons of the 40s. George officially retired from training in 1948 with more than 600 winners. But as that career was winding down, the canny horseman was preparing his next project. He bought land in Masterton and established Rosswood Stud. George was a firm believer in colonial sires. Many were his best racehorses. The first was Croupier. Beau Veet was retired after injury. He was reunited with George at the stud, alongside his arch racing rival, Beau Lever. However, George's faith in New Zealand bred sires didn't earn the support he might have received 30 years earlier or 40 years later. The veteran horseman let his successors do the talking. He owned the 1947 New Zealand Derby winner, Liebestraum, who was out of Beau Veet. He stayed with the stud business until the early 1950s, when he retired to the Kapiti Coast. He died in 1969. George was regarded as a gentleman's gentleman, an absolute credit to the racing profession. Everybody called him Tommy, probably because he was a tiny man with a puckish personality. But in all other respects, he was a giant in racing. A modest winner and a philosophical loser, Tommy George is a welcome induction into the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame.
I love the videos. I just love those videos. Ladies and gentlemen, representing Tommy George, the family of Simon Gregg, and I'd also like our sponsors, Daphne and Sharon from Working Style, to come forward. Simon, great that video, looking back on the life.
It was absolutely amazing to see all that, yeah, incredible. We'd seen a lot of the photos in the old days in Trentham when we were teenagers heading out. There was a lot of photos on the walls out there, but we've certainly seen nothing like that. It was amazing.
Your link, though, is in the names of your family, too, with the family.
Yeah, that's right. My brother and sister are here with me tonight. My brother Brent was named after Brentwood Stud. And Rosswood was named after my father, Ross, who claims he was the favourite grandson. Sounds like he was. And he actually remembers, he used to go over Rosswood for the school holidays. One of the stories he told me was that Bo Veet was a pretty feisty bugger and used to kick the fence near the house, and Tommy would throw apples at him and yell a few expletives. So, yeah, it was great to see you.
Your passion, any interest in racing for yourselves?
It certainly has grown over the years. I think my sister and I are part owners of the TAB. my brother's owned a couple of horses and done okay over the years, but yeah.
Tommy George, he wasn't tall. Clearly a bit of height's come into the family.
Yeah, it must be from my mother's side, I think. Dad's got a little bit, but it's great to see.
Well, it's great to see Tommy George inducted in the Hall of Fame, and thank you, Simon, on behalf of everybody, and welcome to the family, the Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, Simon Gregg representing Tommy George. We move to our eighth inductee. This is a gentleman, ladies and gentlemen, who has shaped many lives, influenced many people. We've heard already from James McDonald. He's a man who has also influenced my own career. Our next inductee is Sir Peter Vella.
Sir Peter Vella's commitment and service to thoroughbred racing were first honoured with a New Zealand Order of Merit and then in 2014 a knighthood. Now it's appropriate for him to receive the highest accolade from the industry he has done so much to support and influence. Racing wasn't in the Vella blood when Sir Peter's father arrived from Croatia in 1929. He knew about fishing and established several successful enterprises. Sir Peter and his brother Philip grew up in that industry, but racing became their passion. Sir Peter's early racing connections were economic. He was paid to work on the starting stalls during race days while he was at Waikato University. Graduation as a teacher took him to Narawahia High School, where he found another horse fanatic in the local butcher. Charlie Farrell encouraged Sir Peter to watch one of his horses being trained. That's when he met Laurie Laxon. The friendship was instant, and soon after, Vella had horses with the future Hall of Famer. The first was Dominus, which was part-owned with university mates. In the late 70s, the brothers Peter and Philip bought a property at Te Kowhai. Their plan was to predominantly race fillies and to start a broodmare band. The boutique operation expanded quickly. In 1980, Pencarrow, near Cambridge, was purchased. Their strategy was to buy pedigree, and if they were any good, breed from it. The plan worked. Nobel Heights was the first success. She became the Vella's first Group 1 winner and was Champion Filly of the Year. Nobel Heights earned the title of Foundation Mare for Pencarrow. Next was Richburg by Vice Regal out of Mary Mead. Leading her at the sales was Leon Casey. He soon became Pencarrow's stud master and was the rock and the brains of the organisation for more than 30 years. Richburg was one of Pencarrow's most important broodmares. She was the dam of Romani Conti, the dam of Ethereal, and also of Grand Eshizo, who was the dam of Darcy Brahma. All those stars were bred at Pencarrow's stud. One of her early foals to a mating with Sir Tristram was Romani Conti. That Hong Kong Cup win, back then a Group 3, is one of Vella's favourites.
And driving through is Romani Conti, but it's Frara Motivation by a length to River Verdon. Romani Conti coming through nicely, followed by Charmaneer down the outside, but Fra won't give in. Romani Conti gradually picking it up from Motivation. Romani Conti gets to the front, close to home from Fra. Charmaneer late on the scene, but Romani Conti takes the cup back to New Zealand, wins it 3/4 to Fra.
The photo of Philip Vella picking up the 17-kilogram trophy with one hand always makes Sir Peter smile. Romani Conti went on to have Ethereal, another Hall of Famer who won the elusive Caulfield Melbourne Cup double.
Give the slip, well clear at the 200-metre mark though. Down the outside is Ethereal starting to close. Give the slip with Ethereal coming home. Give the slip in front. Ethereal's coming hard. The Caulfield Company has grabbed the lead. And Ethereal does the double. Ethereal's won it from Give the Slip.
Romani Conti also produced Grand Esche's Zoe, whose first foal, Dane Hill, went on to top the Karaka yearling sales in 2004 with Darcy Brahma. He became a leading sire. Over the years, Pincaro topped the sales five times, while sticking to their philosophy of never standing a stallion at stud. They knew the importance and value of sires, holding shares and investing in many stallion. The Vellas never shied away from responsibility as industry leaders. When overseas investors wanted to buy Wrightsons in 1996, the thoroughbred industry approached the brothers to buy the business. They did, renaming it New Zealand Bloodstock, on the proviso that it was for the short term. 24 years later and counting, New Zealand Bloodstock is the benchmark for many sales companies around the world. The Vellas transformed Karaka from unfinished boxes and paradeways into a magnificent facility. Sir Peter attributes the backing from breeders in making New Zealand Bloodstock a success. Breeding and racing are inextricably linked. The distinctive blue and white Vella racing colours have been winners in many countries. Sir Peter's favourite event is Royal Ascot. Twice, he's been honoured to join the four-carriage royal procession with the Queen.
And from New Zealand, it's great to welcome Sir Peter Vella and his wife Pamela.
It's the racing carnival spirit that he loves most about Royal Ascot. It inspired him to introduce a twilight meeting at Ellerslie before the sales. Sir Peter is very proud of the event's success.
To arrive here tonight, well before the first, car parks were full, galleries were full, and the people have had a great night, and it is now established as a truly sensational racing evening.
He adores the fun, the pomp, and ceremony in racing, but he's always aware of the duty to give back to the industry. Sir Peter has been on too many racing boards and committees to name. Significantly, he was one of the people appointed to the Racing Industry Transition Agency in 2019. The task? Turning around the fortunes of the New Zealand racing industry. Many awards for Filly of the Year, Owner of the Year, and Breeder of the Year fill the shelves. Sir Peter acknowledges that to achieve that kind of success requires an army of passionate people. Deep down, it's those friendships he made over the years that provided the most treasured memories of New Zealand racing.
A massive round of applause indeed, folks, for a wonderful man who's done so much for our New Zealand racing industry, no question about it. Sir Peter Vella, New Zealand's Bloodstock sponsored Andrew Seabrook, will also come to the stage. Sir Peter, congratulations. As we saw in that wonderful video, we talk about, you know, people, giants in the industry, and you certainly are one of them. You've been to Government House, you've been a recipient at Government House a couple of times with the knighthood as well. But I reckon this is right up there, isn't it, really, for you?
Unquestionably right there.
Because at the end of the day, I mean, this is what you live for, don't you, the racing industry?
Exactly, and it's just such a delight to see a wonderful group here, all who have the same love of a fantastic sport, and it's just great to be part of it.
How did it all start for you? Was it a person in Narrawarra tapping on the shoulder, as that video said? Was it a case that you're a person who liked to have a little bit of a punt? How did it all sort of come together?
Well, it was probably a combination of all of them. I used to get working on the starting stalls at university. It was $13 a day from sort of dawn till dusk. But I relied on the infinite wisdom of the jockeys that wanted a little help here and there. But it didn't work. I knew at the end of the day I still had to go and get a job somewhere and do some work. But it was a great beginning, and I enjoyed every bit of it.
You came along and met someone like Laurie Laxon, who's also, as we all know, in the Hall of Fame too. And that one horse, that Royal Heights, I mean, she was a gem of a racehorse, and I suppose that got the blood boiling even more.
Yeah, she taught me a lot of things because... Philip and I were just then thinking about, we'd raced a few geldings and we thought, well, let's try and do something a little more and maybe buy some fillies and breed from them subsequently. And we didn't really have the budget to do it properly, so we were looking for pedigree with maybe some faults, and Noble Heights came within that category. And in that she failed the vet most of the time, and but we took a punt on it, and you know, she ended up a great mare.
Absolutely. Battle Heights, of course, is part of that family as well. Tell us a little bit about that Hong Kong trip. I mean, how did that come about? Because it was in the infancy, wasn't it, that race?
It was in its infancy, but it was still an important event on the calendar, and there was a variety of conditions that you couldn't be a Group 1 winner or you carried a penalty, and so on and so forth. So we took it quite cautiously, but we thought we had a horse that could do the job, possibly, and so it proved. She was probably best remembered in that for winning that, in that the horse that finished third to her, who had started favourite, ended up to be that lovely French mare, the mother of Galileo and See the Stars and Co. So the horses were certainly there at that time, just not with the Group 1 performances.
Group 1 races, it's turned out to be, though, for sure. And roll on to Ethereal, I mean, a champion horse, and once again inducted to the Hall of Fame. Melbourne Cup that day, I was a little bit nervous. I was watching the race, watching the rain come down, cutting up a little bit, when give it the snip, got clear and looked as though it had the race parceled up. I mean, but just thinking about that race, what were your confidence levels like going into the Cup with the way the weather was playing?
They were pretty low, to be honest. When I woke up, opened the window, the curtains, and looked out, and it was a pretty dark and dull day. And I talked to Brent Thompson, and he said, no, I'll go and have a look and check the track. And whether he ever did, I'm not sure, but but we decided to run, and it was a good decision.
Outstanding stuff, for sure. Now, New Zealand Bloodstock, from Wrightson's to New Zealand Bloodstock, back there in 1996, when you signed the dotted line, did you believe it would grow to what it is at the moment? And I guess in some respects, it was going to be a bit of a... You had to do it, didn't you, really? I mean, the New Zealand industry begged people to come on board and be part of this, and no doubt you worked hard on that.
Yeah, no, unquestionably. We did it because we loved the business, and when Sir Patrick came and sort of instructed us that that was the path that we needed to go on for the next couple of years, we had no option but to give it a try. Look, it's been a tough time. It's a tough business, and nothing like the fishing business or others that we knew, but we're delighted that we did it and glad that it's where it is.
Absolutely, and as we saw before too, you've built up another carnival at Ellerslie, part of it, you know, with the Auckland Racing Club. The marriage is so good, isn't it, really? Because that is just growing bigger and bigger each year.
Yeah, you only have to look at the wagering on it, and I think last year it was probably the third or fourth biggest event of the year. The year just gone, they bet on six races, just a little over $5 million, and that says it all.
Certainly does. Before we let you sit down, I mean, earlier on, James gave you tremendous plaudits. I mean, you've been a person, he's been like a, he's told me once, he's like, you're like a second father to him, James McDonald, and you must be proud of the fact that he's been inducted as well.
Oh, look, it's really made the night for me. I first ran into James. George Simon rang me one day and he said, could you come and do the presentation at the awards night for the apprentices? And so I went down and the winner I can't remember what year it was, but I remember he was 47 and a half kilos, so it was a fair time ago. And James came up, he was the winner, he came up and I congratulated him. And he said, Mr. Vella, I'm ready for the blue and white hoops. And I thought, geez, this is a good boy, this. And he was pretty quickly into them, and he's in them any time he wants them now.
I'm sure he would be. We're proud of you, Sir Peter. You've done so much for the racing industry. You're well and truly, richly deserved to be part of the inductee tonight. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you very much.
Number 9, lucky last in the inductee stakes tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is Sunbride.
Every stud dreams of that one special horse, the champion who changes everything. For Tuparare in the Wairarapa, now known as Little Avondale Stud, Sunbride was that horse. She was a foundation mare like no other. The stud owners, the Williams family, could also be regarded as one of the foundation families of the New Zealand thoroughbred industry. Three generations of Williams have been part of thoroughbred sales for 80 years. How Sunbride came to Tuparare and how Tuparare even became a stud was due to a woman who defined the meaning of being a great horse person. Nancy Teshmaker married fighter pilot Alistair Williams in 1938, on the understanding that her two horses and dogs were also part of the marriage. The 1,200-acre Williams property was largely cattle and sheep at the time, until the new couple steadily increased the number of horses. They made a great team. Nancy, or Andy as she's known to most, had an affinity with horses. She understood nutrition and the importance of yearling presentation at sales. Alistair understood pedigrees and was one of the small, determined band of enthusiasts who created the New Zealand Thoroughbred Association that we know today. One of Nancy's early purchases was four-year-old mare Sunbride, sent from England in 1946. Wartime restrictions on racing limited her to a few unsuccessful starts as a two-year-old. But Nancy saw something special in the mare, who barely reached 15 hands. She liked Sunbride's head for its classic English thoroughbred look. Sunbride was purchased for 1,250 guineas at a Trentham spring sale. Sunbride was by Tai Yang out of Graceful Bride. It wasn't an appealing pedigree, which Alistair didn't fail to tell his wife. It took several years for Sunbride's true merit as a producer of high-class horses to be revealed. The first four fillies failed to impress, and there was talk of selling Sunbride. Nancy Williams' defense of her mare is part of family folklore. "I refuse to entertain any thought of selling Sunbride. When I go broke and I'm evicted from Tuparare, Sunbride and I will walk down the road together." That conviction was timely, as Sunbride's fortunes were about to change. The foal she was carrying was the 1957 Melbourne Cup winner, Straight Draw.
Straight Draw and Prince Darius staging a mammoth duel. The whips are out, and Straight Draw goes as great as a gun barrel to beat Prince Darius.
Straight Draw was owned by Australian media magnate Ezra Norton. He developed a liking for Sunbride progeny and tried to buy five of her 13 offspring. Ezra's last Sunbride purchase was perhaps her most famous, General Command. He became Australia's top stakes winner of the season, winning 13 races, including the Metropolitan, Sydney, Fisher, Queen Elizabeth, Chipping Norton, and AJC Autumn Stakes. The one purchase that fell through for Mr. Norton, a colt that went on to be called Ilumqua. After failing a vet inspection, the colt returned to Tuparare, where Nancy leased him to Alistair for a shilling a year to race. Unsoundness dogged Ilumqua throughout his career. He was considered unlucky to finish third and second in the 1960 and 1963 Melbourne Cups after winning the 1960 Caulfield Cup.
Ilumqua's raced up on the outside to take the lead, and with a half furlong to run, you can put away your glasses. Ilumqua can run out by Williams and is striding away to win it very easily.
But he still provided much joy for the Williams. Ilumqua became one of the best stayers of his era in New Zealand, winning 9 races, including the Awapuni Gold and the Williamstown Cups. The great mare's progeny were popular. Sunbride created history for Nancy Williams when her Sabean colt topped the yearling sales at £6,000, the first woman to top the sales. Nancy achieved the same feat at the national sales again in 1968 and 1974. The 74 record was significant. It was the first time a yearling broke the $100,000 mark. And this was for a yearling from one of Sunbride's daughters and final foal, Bridesmaid. All three of Sunbride's famous sons, Straight Draw, Ilumqua, and General Command, returned to spend their retirement at Tuparare. They retained their popularity with the media.
Well, this friend of mine here, his name
is Tommy. Now, Tommy is 35 years of age. In fact, Tommy is his nickname, and he's still got a bit of spirit in him yet.
The star trio made regular appearances at Te Parare annual yearling sales parades, but the real showstopper was the mare who made it all possible, Sunbride. Sunbride was the first to win the Broodmare of the Year twice, in 1961 and 1968. Her daughter, Dicidiana, won it in 1972, is Dam of Australian Horse of the Year, Diana. Sunbride was an impressive producer of high-class horses. Of her 13 foals, 11 were winners. Her stakes earnings in today's money would be over $3.5 million. Nearly half a century after her death, Sunbride's bloodlines have made a comeback. A fifth generation to Sunbride, Sire Prosser, is standing at Rich Hill Stud. The Williams family are forever grateful for Sunbride and her role in shaping New Zealand's thoroughbred industry.
I don't know why I'm nervous about this, to be quite frank. Only because if I was talking to you, Tom, I wouldn't be quite as nervous. But I know what's coming up next very shortly, and that is Buds. Tom, I got to say, when I looked at the video, you've thrown very much to the father, Alistair.
I suppose in science...
Which is nice.
I was going to say, it's not such a bad thing. However, I must say that the dam side has a fair bit to do with our family.
It certainly has. The influence she has, Nancy, on the entire family in terms of involvement in racing, that's held it together, been the glue.
Most certainly has. And I guess that's the passion she had for the industry and also very much the talent to run with her thought on her opinions on horses and to follow them through, despite the fact that my father, who actually was a soldier and not a fighter pilot, I'd be the fighter pilot, he had some fairly forthright opinions, but mother was pretty staunch in saying, as you see on the clip tonight, that where Sunbride went, she went.
I got to say, they worked well together, though, didn't they?
Yeah, they certainly did, and they complemented each other because she had the practical knowledge and the practical skills, and the old man who eventually ended up by coming on board with Thoroughbreds had the view that he studied pedigrees, he understood them, and it was a very good combination.
Certainly was. Let's move to Buzz. Buzz, come forward. Yeah, I know, Buzz. I know, but you know, I had to look up what your real name was. How did you go from Richard to Buzz?
It's quite a long story, actually. Do you want the truth?
Well, something that's going to be played after 10 o'clock, I don't mind.
Okay, well, I was such a pain in the ass when I was a little fella that my aunt called me Mosquito. They shortened that to Buzz, and so I got to that. So I'm very similar to you.
Thank you. Listen, we've just heard from your brother. Your involvement in the racing, obviously the passion stemmed from that. You've carried it on. Your son now carrying on. It must be a great pleasure to see now, what, four generations?
Yeah, no, it seriously is. I mean, mother did a great job with the old man's combination. Then I suppose it's a bit like the Roman Empire. You know, it collapsed after a wee while. We did it a lot quicker, though. So it went down to the bottom. Then Sam came along, and thank God he got Katrina, and they lifted the thing right back up again to where it is now. And it actually goes pretty well. Sue's had a little bit to do with it. And Gary Chittick, I have to say, had a bit to do with it too, because he told me that if an idiot like I could make a success of it, then it would be easy for the Chitticks.
We're going the same way I thought we'd go. I knew we'd go this way. How much of the family you still got? Or shall I have to ask Sam that question?
I have to ask Sam that, honestly. We've got a couple left, but not many. I think the mistake we made with the deal is we kept all the fillies, or a lot of them, and that was a mistake. I think what we should have done was got them out to the other studs and let them breed from and go to other stallions. And I think that was a mistake.
Little men.
in hands. Not too many people will be interested in that sort of mare.
What, little birds come with pretty faces, and she was one of them, mate, I can tell you. She had a head like a fairy, a neck like a giraffe, a body like an alderman, a bum not like a cook. It wasn't that big, but it was a decent bum. But she had this big belly, you know. But she had a lovely, lovely neck and a beautiful head. And she was a really petite, sweet little mare.
We're not going any further, ladies and gentlemen. Sunbride, Buzz Williams, Tom Williams, thank you very much. Buzz, you didn't disappoint. Take care. I'll get you to take a photo with Melissa. Come forward. Just one. Before we move to the Leishman Media Award, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make one acknowledgement here, and I made a brief mention to it earlier with regards to the videos, and I'd like Annie Otway to stand up. Annie, I know you are here. Where is Annie? Stand up. Annie has put it together. The videos tonight, she's taken over the running. I think she's done a super job. And in association with the voice of New Zealand Hall of Fame, Racing Hall of Fame, Mr. Peter Elliott, who unfortunately can't be here tonight with us, but one night we will get the voice of the Hall of Fame, Peter Elliott, here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the inductees, but it's now time to move to the Leishman Media Racing Awareness Award presentation, and I'd like to call upon one of the board members, Mr. Mark Chitty, to come forward.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. What a fantastic evening of celebration. In 2014, the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame Board recognised that many mainstream media journalists do not have an awareness of the New Zealand racing and breeding industries and what it offers and contributes to the wider New Zealand community. As a board led by the late Chris Luoni, we set about changing that awareness, and so was established the Philip Leishman Media Racing Awareness Award in honour of an inaugural Hall of Fame director and international and iconic New Zealand sports commentator, Philip Leishman. Philip was a consummate professional in everything that he did. He had an absolute passion for racing, and he created the standard and platform for the many sports presenters that followed. His company, Sports Inc., has played a very important role in developing our famous inductee videos, with the likes of producers Steve Johnson and more recently Annie Otway. Philip was a great storyteller who loved being part of the racing fraternity, and as a board we felt there was no better way to continue the industry storytelling than with the development of this award. Our award recipients have been given exposure to all things industry: stable work days, track work gallop mornings, jump out mornings, trials, stud working days, New Zealand bloodstock sales, sale days, and ultimately Group 1 race days. Past recipients of this award have been Country TV's Vanessa Pert-Smith and TV New Zealand's India Leishman, and current TV One sports presenter Guy Hervelt. Our 2020 recipient is a young man who grew up in Rangiora, attended New Zealand Broadcasting School from 2014 to 2016, and on graduation worked at NZME for 4 years, where he worked in such roles as the executive producer for the Daniel McCarty afternoons on Radio Sport, as a setup producer for the Larry Williams Drive Show and Rachel Smalley's Early Edition Show on News Talk TV. In August 2020, he took a leap of faith and created Louis HW Media, and has already worked with the likes of legendary yachting commentator Peter Montgomery during the recent America's Cup. A young man with huge passion for our industry, well connected to the Boys Get Paid movement, and responsible for numerous social media videos and podcasts, with many of you that are seated here tonight. Our 2020 Philip Leishman Media Racing Awareness Award winner is Louis Herman Watt.
G'day everybody, Louis here, just checking in virtually, of course, to accept the Leishman Media Racing Awareness Award, which I received a couple of years ago now. It feels like time has absolutely flown on. Just so stoked to receive this award at the time, and still am. Obviously named after a very, very great man. And to Chris Luaney, another awesome, awesome, inspirational character. I just want to give a massive shout out there. I was so thrilled when this award was given to me, and I still am. And I think about Chris and obviously Philip quite a lot. To racing, to the good people in it, the idea is to grow the game, and this what this award was, to get it to more people in front of more eyeballs, and I hope that I've been able to do that with Radio Sport and Boys Get Paid, of course, Luke and Ben. Everything we do is we try to build the racing people up and the racing industry up, because you are all such good sorts. Have a great night. Have an ale or maybe 15, 20 if you're Rodney Schick. Have a great party, and again, I'm gutted I can't be there, but I'm thrilled to be accepting this award, and we'll catch you up soon.
What a great recipient, Louis Herman Watt, ladies and gentlemen. The future is bright for the industry. Boys Get Paid and Louis Herman Watt. We're going to move to the final act, and I'm going to change to the microphone as we change over. Ladies and gentlemen, we have three live auction items to sell for you. I have Des Coppins, I have my lovely wife to the left, Natalie Davis, and I have Cherry Taylor, the chairman who can do it all. Yeah. Put your hands together for Cherry Taylor, I gotta tell you, she makes it happen. You don't say no to Cherry. You don't say no. Ladies and gentlemen, the first of our live auction items, and we do appreciate the support. From Little Avondale Stud, we've seen the Williams family with Sunbride being inducted. This is a nomination to Per Encanto, the son of Street Cry, their resident stallion, their extremely successful son, one of the more established sires in New Zealand that is available, commercial sires. He will cover a book this year of only 130. He will cover only 130 mares this year. His fee is being raised to $25,000. Ladies and gentlemen, off the back of a very successful out the back of a very successful career. And the beautiful thing about Per Encanto, for me, it doesn't matter whether they're fillies or colts. But ladies and gentlemen, we do have a little presentation to make.
Little Avondale, standing Per Encanto. 8 years, 259 Australasian yearlings and RTR horses sold, averaging 11 times the service fee. Little Avondale, standing time test. 23 Australasian yearlings sold, averaging 7.4 times the service fee. Little Avondale, the New Zealand stud that stands the top two stallions for return on service fee. Little Avondale, big on winning, backing the breeder since 1940.
There you go, they didn't get me to do the voiceover. All right. And I got 10,000 to start, ladies and gentlemen, nomination. I can tell you that the New Zealand Racing Hall of Fame 12-5 is putting up the life hole 15 here. 15,000, 17-5. 17,500 winner to 70, $20,000 winner to 22 here. 22 here now. 3, 23, 23, 4, 24,000, 5, 25,000, 6, 20. $6,000 winner to $26,000 winner to 26, 26 now, $26,000 winner to 26, the nomination to Per Encanto. 7, 8, 28. Not like you to say no, not when she's 28,000. I'm just lucky she's not looking at me. 28,000, 28 now, 28. I'll tell you what, I'll take one. 28, 9, 20, 30, 30,000. 30, but not like you to run second, Cherry. That's all I'm saying. Yeah, 30,000. At 30,000, the bid's direct to me. At 30,000, I sell for 30. Nick Bright Hill Stud. No. Frank Cook Mystery Downs. Thank you. Frank Cook Mystery Downs. Thank you. Nick King, Bright Hill Stud on his behalf. Ladies and gentlemen. We're going to bring up the jackets, they tell me. Is that right? 30. 30. You're getting like James McDonald. Wasn't I good enough? No. Daphne and Sharon are coming up. We're going to bring the jackets up, I think, to the left. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to start with the women's jacket. Now, these just aren't the jackets you're going to get. These jackets, the working style made, are made to measure jackets. Yes. That means they get fitted.
That's for Buzz Williams, just so he doesn't understand. He understands. Handmade in Portugal, ladies and gentlemen, is lightweight with unparalleled movement. It is a garment that has lasted a lifetime. You style your own unique one-off tailor-made jacket by selecting fabrics from the world's leading cloth merchants, along with the personalized options of styling, features, and finishes. This is the men's. We're doing the men's first, they tell us. Sorry, that's why I was a little bit hesitant. Good spotting, wasn't it? Good spot. You got to ask the question these days. Here we go. We're doing the men's first. We are doing the men's first. Made to measure, working style. As I say, we thank Daphne and Sharon for their support. Here we go. Handmade. Quality, ladies and gentlemen. This is the men's. We're right. This is the men's. Ladies and gentlemen here. And I got $1,000 to start. $1,000. And I'll take $100 rises right from the start. And I bet $1,100. $1,200. $1,300. $1,300. One hour to $1,300. One hour to $1,300. One hour to worth over $2,000, ladies and gentlemen. About $1,300. $1,400. $1,400. One hour to $1,500. $1,600. Now. $1,600. Natalie, I hope you're not bidding for me, Natalie. $1,800. $2,000. $2,000. One hour to $2,000. One hour to $2,000. $2,000. At $2,000, I'm selling right. $2,000. I'll take $100. $2,000. Now going to a great cause, you know that. And I bet $2,000 going to sell here to Terry at $2,000. What do you say, Natalie? At $2,000 goes though, I'm going to sell. I sell to Terry Taylor for $2,001. Ooh, just in time. That's why she's my wife. I take it all my auctions these days. 2-2. 2-2. 2-2 now. Get him again, Natalie. Get him again, Natalie. 2-2, get the three, Natalie. 2-2, at 2,200, one more if you want it. Goes though, for the one of a single, look good on James, wouldn't it? At 2,200, goes, bidding, three. You know you could do it in hoops as well. Four, just saying, 2-4. You should be drinking something stronger. 2-4. At 2,400, I sell to Cherry for 2-4. Thank you, Cherry. Brent Taylor. Yeah, you know what I love about Brent? He don't even move his eyes, his hands, or anything. You're lucky you haven't got a twitch, that's all I'll say. You'd go home with a lot. Righto, ladies and gentlemen, here we go to the women's check. We tried to offer this earlier, but this is the women's check. After 34 years. I'm doing the introduction. Thank you. After 34 years as New Zealand's leading menswear brand, Working Style have also revealed its feminine side. W for working, S for style is fresh. New collection made entirely of impeccable tailor-made garments for women. Looking beautiful, ladies. Can I just, as are yourselves. Also made in Portugal, our world-class ateliers. Is that right? Very good, thank you. Working Style gives you the power to create your own garments with the help of their in-store tailors. Ladies and gentlemen, you've seen the men's make 2,400. May I suggest something similar here? Is there 2,000? 1,000, thank you. You're going to look good at rent. $1,000. 1,000 bid. $1,000 an hour to $1,000 an hour. I'll take 200s on. $1,200. Look good in Sydney. $1,400. $1,600. $1,800. $2,000. $2,000. $2,000. And that's New Zealand dollars. 2-2. 2-2. 3. 2-3. Two, and you could do it in tangerine if you like. 2-3, 2-3, 4, 2-5, 2-5, 6, 2-6 now, at 2-6, 7, 8, where's 3? Now you want my job. 3,000, 3,000 to the left, at $3,000 and I'm going to sell left. At $3,000 and I sell the Working Style women's jacket for $3,000. You're going to be known as an underbidder. at $3,000. Have you got one? One! Still got it. Still got it. 3-1. At 3,100. 2. 3-2. Now what do we do? At 3-2. 3. 3-3. You just got to touch a nerve. 3-3. At 3-3. You're not going to... How are you going to go home sitting on the plane for 3.5 hours and you didn't bid again? Just one more. At 3-3 and I set 4. 3-4, it's going to Sydney. It's going to Sydney and I sell for 3-4. James McDonald. Thank you, underbidder. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is the last one. This is the 3-day wellness retreat at Resolution Retreats near Cambridge. Jolene's here, beautifully attired too, may I say, outstandingly dressed. Ladies and gentlemen, Mother's Day's coming up. This retreat for 3 days is valued, a wellness retreat, at $3,000. Ladies, thank you too, from working staff. Thank you very much, definitely. Is there 3 or 4,000? It's worth 3. You got 1,000 bid. $1,000 went down to $1,250. $1,250 went down to $1,250. $1,500. $1,500 went down to $1,750. How much you had to drink, John Thompson? $1,750. $72,000. $2,000 went down to $2,000. This is real money, you know. $2,000. $2,000 went down to $2,000. $2,250. $2,250. $2,500. $2,500. $2,500 went down to $2,500. $750. $2,750. $2,750 make you 3 wear. At $2,750 and I sell to the back of the room. $2,750, Cherry, it's not you, I'm just saying.
I know.
At $2,750, I'm going to sell. Who'd like to be 3, but I'm going to sell? At $2,750, the wellness retreat, I sell to the back of the room, I sell for $3,000. $2,50. $3,250. $3,250. $3,250. Just a one? $3,250. Just one. Just one. Just one more. Come on, just one. No? When you say no, no, right? At $3,250, can I change your mind? You're allowed to. At $3,250 and I sell for $3,250. Is it? David Archer. David Archer. Thank you, underbidder. David Archer. And don't forget the silent auction. We're not going to close for a little while. Thank you to my lovely bid spotters, Cherry.
I told you I was a bit rusty. Hadn't been behind a microphone for such a long time. Thank you, everybody. It's great to honour such wonderful people year in, year out. We sit around the table. We thrash it out with so many names that come forward. We'll be doing that again later on this year. And I reckon tonight we've achieved 100% success. Some worthy winners this year for the inductees. Fantastic.